kind of doing vitamin D levels and everything. And then if you need somebody, I prescribe them vitamin D. It's tested and possible for the reduction of vitamin D. That's kind of my brain decision when it comes to this, but hopefully we'll have a little bit of a better understanding of post-operative matrix and spine. And it'll be a good segue, I think, for the most confident story we're talking about. So, if anyone knows who this is, this is Curtis Mendelson. He was an early GI in 1946, published pretty extensively about the risk of aspiration and respiratory issues during childcare. And he was one of the big proponents, actually, of the first development of NGO after midnight, the way that we actually progress people to the point of how we might be able to do the patient's treatment. And then basically, going slowly through this, and considering our general physical education, we think about the return of bowel signs and passing gas. It's a sign that bowel can do this, but there's actually not a lot of good evidence behind this, other than some of the historical studies. And there's a shift even within the environment that we are for really achieving and being beneficial to patients and other interventions and nutrition. And so this is kind of an interesting study we found just a little bit like that. This is like a career where 179 patients who underwent uncomplicated laparoscopic endarterectomy. And this is the randomized them to traditional nutrition, which is basically pills, if they're tolerated, kind of move forward, and then you can have bowel signs, and then you can progress in the future much slower. Versus patient controlled nutrition, it's basically you say, hey, what are you hungry at? You can hungry for this meal time, but they're not going to go to the doctor and there's an order on their own. This is again, uncomplicated epidemic, no life conditions, something like that. And really, what they found is that there's a statistically significant difference in time, both to whether the diet as well as the length of stay, and of course, the patient's sick with getting more nutrition, and there was no morbidity, abdominal surgery program. When it comes to spine, certainly we have some concerns regarding nutrition. Nodular abdominal aspiration, mitral column surgery, the work for an arterial system, which is a term for a nice but maybe in some more of our complex cases, the idea of a prolonged nutrition deficit, deformity patients who are unable to use the column of that for a period of time, and other aspects like some infection, to kind of get some insight on this, to the nutritional guidelines, this is a great guideline for certainly for people who are looking to enact OS protocols within their institutions and hospitals. And the main issue or main thing is that really if you are looking at what happens post-operative in regards to nutrition, it has to begin pre-operative. And again, looking mostly at the GI literature and general surgery literature, really is a push towards avoiding long periods of fasting, pre-operative carbohydrate loading, and then pre-operative minimizing blood loads, minimizing large volume fluid resuscitation, so both types of fluid management areas, and then early mobilization as well as making more pain control to minimize the blood. So these are kind of all the various principles that I mix, again, the next chapter that we'll get to. But all these have an effect on our ability to feed recommended patients and get them moving from a nutritional standpoint. Spend a little bit of time on the vocabulary we used to do with this. At the OC, we're probably a little behind the curve, maybe about 2 years ago or so. But there's actually really pretty nice data, again, from a survey literature, that at least limiting the amount of fasting, whether it be water administration, whether it be carburetting, whatever the method, there are real effects on morbidity for the patients. There's very low risk of aspiration and regular gastric emptying causing problems in the digestion. And really, carburetting a good evidence in regards to carburetting is sort of hospitalization and reducing post-operative amounts of volume, which is, of course, some of the things that limit the patient's. And they did note that if you Interestingly, if you go to the consensus statements and guidelines for ALS, you look at early oral nutrition as a very important part of it. If you look at the test section, essentially in most studies which I've looked at, the actual direct association with intestinal fibrosis or the performance of these pathways. And I think that, again, this goes to show how my first point, the quality of evidence is low. The recommendation goes higher because at the end of the day, you have things like the intervention, which is relatively benign, and of course, it's kind of common sense, it's going to help our patients. Serena looked at this even back as early as 1998, and you know, complex patient population was fractured. And especially in this phase deformity cases, they randomized patients to TPN versus no TPN. What they found is that the TPN group was simply less likely to deplete their albumin levels, and the no TPN group had a higher number of wound issues and other complications, including UTI and pneumonia. But these differences were not statistically significant, perhaps the sample size is we don't exactly know. What they did note, though, is that the patients were staged, and they had about a 5-day window between the staging. Some of their risk profile in terms of mobility actually started to approach a single stage patient. So perhaps there is something protective in terms of keeping those patients on field for 5 days and then their second stage in a similar vein, this group looked at 58 consecutive patients in 2001. Again, they had stages. What they did was do TPN versus IV fluids and test under the power of PO. And the TPN administration ranged anywhere from 3 to 18 days. And they did not find any difference in true medical complications between the two groups. But from a lab standpoint, there was no less concern to having the patient. Again, difficult to draw any conclusions. This is the corollary study from the HIP literature. And basically, there was a randomized control trial with 18 patients who had hip fractures. And they had regular nutrition versus 3 days of IV and then 7 days of pure nutritional supplementation. And what they found was that the supplement group received higher percentage of the optimal calculated total calories as well as the risk of injury. And they had a substantially lower complication rate. So this is probably a study that shows the most breakthrough in that these are things that can be done very easily. Now, hip fractures are obviously a little bit more of an informed population. They're more prone, more set to be elderly, but I do think that even in some elective and mainstream non-optimized hospital groups, would carry over and have a significant amount. And there, we've got more statistics with other models. Nutritionists can start to show some. This is the one study after the limb pulmonary spine surgery. This is a multimodal nutrition management. And they again with an RCT and they looked at multimodal nutrition management. It's important to look at what that actually means. This began before surgery. They had a nutrition powder, then a protein powder, carb loading, and then postoperatively. With an early feeding. So a lot of this is kind of pre and perioperative management returning patients early prior to early feeding. As opposed to control, where they do normal fasting, no supplementation, no carb loading, and normal postoperative feeding versus the fibers that are exercised post-surgery. And what they found was that there was a reduced need for albumin administration, reduced electrolyte abnormalities, and really just a nice statistical difference in wound infection complications. They did see a decrease in drainage in the multimodal group. One thing I guess is interesting, and it's certainly not my practice, is to measure albumin based on the So essentially, the conclusion is that real pathology is there and post-operative consistent in spine. I do think that the post-operative considerations are going to be pre-operative with limited casting and collaborating and minimizing shocks continue to lose. But abdominal locus suggests that early post-operative feeding shocks is so, and this has been proven even in surgeries or mastomosis and infections, early feeding can have some benefits, particularly in there's very weak evidence that any kind of post-op